what kind of curve is uniquely defined by these two points? A line. How about 3 points? A circle. This basic geometry is ancient history. Euclid proved it more than 2,000 years ago in his seminal math treatise, Elements. Now try to figure out the shape of a curve that passes through a million points in 1,000 dimensions and is super twisty. What would that look like? Although daunting, finding a solution to this problem is fundamental to probing deeper principles of math. And the solution also holds the potential to improve digital data storage, the security of your crypto wallet, and the privacy of electronic communications. It's called the interpolation problem, and two young mathematicians, Eric Larson and Isabel Vogt of Brown University, have solved it.
The interpolation problem asks, if you fix some general collection of points, when is there a curve of some specified type through those points?
In search of answers, the pair chipped away at the problem for years.
We started out tackling cases in small dimensional spaces to try to get our hands dirty and see the sort of techniques that we would need. And then I think around 2019 or so, we came up with a good idea that we thought might help us solve the whole problem.
Along the way, their collaboration took on a whole new dimension.
Well, we got married in 2017.
Much of the groundwork for a potential solution was laid out 150 years ago by German mathematicians Alexander von Brill and Max Noether.
Before you can ask, what properties does a given type of curve have? You need to first answer the question of, what types of curves are there?
The theorem predicts what types of curves can exist based on three properties. The first is dimension.
You could think about a curve in actual physical space, that would be a three-dimensional space, but we don't constrain ourselves to two dimensions or three dimensions.
The second quantity is the degree of a curve.
So you should think here, like how twisty or wobbly the curve is.
The third is the genus, or number of holes a curve has.
Curves themselves have a sort of topological property. But if you were to look at the solutions over the complex numbers, then it's gonna look like something that's two-dimensional. So it could look like a sphere, or it could look like the surface of a donut, or it could look like the surface of a two-hole donut. In general, it can have any number of holes.
It wasn't until the 1980s that modern math offered a proof of Brill-Noether, and this opened doors to the interpolation problem. Larson and Vogt were determined to solve the problem for all possible types of curves.
We had to come up with three different ways of breaking the curve into simpler curves. So we take some curve, it's complicated, it's very wobbly. So we take this wobbly curve and we break it in three different ways.
By breaking down the complex curve in multiple steps, Larson and Vogt were able to get something simple enough that they could attack it with their bare hands.
We knew how slippery it was, how you really had to work hard to get everything to match up.
Larson and Vogt's proof confirmed the interpolation problem in all cases, showing that curves will always interpolate through the expected number of points, with only four exceptions, which they also explained. The couple's proof is a powerful tool for exploring a whole new class of ideas.
Bit of a surprise to you, finally complete it. You know, you've just been thinking, oh, this is what I do, is I work on this problem, but then you're like, wow, it's done.
More than 2,000 years ago, the Greek mathematician Xenodorus argued that a sphere is the optimal shape of a single bubble. This may seem obvious, but it took until the late 19th century to prove it mathematically. What about a cluster of multiple bubbles? Researchers study bubbles to both better understand their geometric properties and potentially improve everything from computer algorithms and biological cell models to firefighting foams. For decades, mathematicians have sought the optimal configuration of larger bubble clusters. But it turns out, the solution is one of the hardest problems in geometry. The bubble problem can be stated simply. What configuration of bubbles encloses a given number of volumes while minimizing surface area?
And the key point is that the surfaces are allowed to, like, if I smash my bubbles together, I'm allowed to save on the surface that's between them. I mean, it's an optimization problem. And that's such a universal kind of problem with all kinds of applications.
From our own experience of blowing bubbles, we know that larger clusters of bubbles tend to form tight clumps rather than a long chain. But how can we know whether these formations are actually optimal? In the 1990s, John Sullivan, now of the Technical University of Berlin, formed a guiding conjecture.
He described what we now call a standard bubble or a standard bubble cluster. They're spheres, they meet at 120 degree angles, they all touch. There could be lots of different ways to achieve that. It turns out that that's not the case.
Sullivan's conjecture states, if the number of volumes you want to enclose is at most one greater than the dimension, there's one cluster configuration that's the best.
There's basically one way to achieve this, and his conjecture was that this way is the optimal way.
To visualize Sullivan's optimal cluster, place 4 points equidistant on a sphere. Inflate the points into bubbles, or disks, on the surface until they bump into each other. Keep inflating them until the entire sphere is covered. We end up with a symmetric cluster that all touch and meet at 120 degree angles. Now place the sphere on a flat plane. Add a light at the North Pole to cast a two-dimensional shadow of three bubbles. Rolling the sphere around creates clusters of Sullivan's shadow bubbles that can enclose any three areas. By 2002, mathematicians had proved Sullivan's conjecture for the double bubble. And at this point, some speculated another 100 years would pass before a proof for three bubbles could be found. But then, Emmanuel Millman of Technion University and Joan Neiman of the University of Texas Austin entered the picture.
So what we were working on was sort of the probabilistic version of this problem. And we were interested, actually, originally, we would have been happy to do double bubble at the beginning. We were like, you know, we have to come up with something new, right? And so we came up with some new things.
After some success solving the analogous probabilistic bubble problem, the pair hit a snag transferring their new techniques to the geometric one.
So we were stuck on this for a long time. And definitely a breakthrough came when we kind of gave up, to be honest.
Millman and Neiman realized that if you give bubbles one extra dimension of space, you get a bonus. The best bubble cluster will have mirror symmetry across a central plane.
We were like, okay, let's give up on what we were trying to do and see what we can get from the symmetry. And then as soon as we had that symmetry, that symmetry combined with what we had been working on for the previous 3 years, all of a sudden, then we were able to move on from there.
But Millman and Neiman's proof of Sullivan's conjecture for triple bubbles in dimensions three and up is not the end of the story.
We're stuck at a maximum of five bubbles right now. But I feel like it's just like a tiny little thing that we are not seeing, and then that problem will go away.
Take a set of points and start randomly connecting them with lines. At what point will an interesting pattern emerge? Like a triangle, or a Hamiltonian cycle, a chain of lines that passes through each point exactly once. In a branch of math called combinatorics, graphs like these are valuable tools for probing the inner workings of complex systems.
A graph is just another name for a network.
Networks are everywhere around, like Facebook network. You can think about traffic networks, or business networks and things like that.
But real-life networks can be huge and hard to study, so mathematicians use random graphs to model their properties.
In the random graph theory, finding thresholds is a central subject. People worked on finding threshold for each of interesting properties.
Interesting properties can emerge as you increase the density of lines in a random graph. The sudden moment of change is defined by a threshold. In nature, thresholds are responsible for abrupt transformations and the emergence of complex patterns.
But it turns out that determining threshold is extremely difficult.
Instead, mathematicians use a method to arrive at a ballpark figure.
There's a very natural lower bound to the threshold that we call the expectation threshold. The expectation threshold turns out to be much easier to estimate or determine.
In 2006, mathematicians Jeff Kahn and Gil Kalai posed their expectation threshold conjecture. It states that the gap between the expectation threshold and the real threshold is at most a logarithmic factor, but sometimes smaller or even non-existent.
The Kahn-Kalai conjecture just gives one simple solution to find out the location of the threshold for many, many interesting properties. So it's just so powerful, and it was hard to believe that this conjecture is true.
that was until two mathematicians at Stanford, Jin-Young Park and Hui Pham, stumbled onto an elegant six-page solution after a long sleepless night.
It really came about by really not working or aiming directly at the Kahn-Kali conjecture.
It was a surprise that we found out another way.
The pair were instead working on several related conjectures.
Like, you know, you're like taking a walk that you aim at a seemingly very different and distant destination, but on the way, you are suddenly able to find, you know, some very surprising hidden beauty.
A key breakthrough was the realization that a method developed in the pursuit of one conjecture could be used in a different manner to solve Kahn-Kali. The solution utilized a mathematical object called a cover.
You can think about a cover as essentially a kind of necessary condition or a witness to the fact that the network satisfied the property.
Park and Pham employed an algorithm to sample subsets of a random graph to home in on the cover.
In the end, we verified this cover is small, in particular also. So that is exactly how we proved the conjecture.
Park and Pham's concise proof of Kahn-Kali is expected to lead to new breakthroughs.
This would allow us to get a much better handle on complex properties of networks. And this is certainly useful in many applications, not just in math or in probabilistic combinatorics, because the networks are involved everywhere.